Good evening, everybody. We are back for another edition of Reasonable Doubt, brought to you by the Harris County Criminal Lawyers Association. I'm your host, Jimmy Ardwan, along with my co-host, Julio Vela. What's going on, my friend?
Hey, man. Astros are up.
Dude.
Horns are on the table. My main girl, Vic's in presence.
Hello, good evening.
It's going to be a good show tonight, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be with you for the next hour. And coming out from behind the booth to join us
are very exciting.
Our usual, what do we call you back in
producer, the magician in the booth.
That's right.
Makes all the loveliness happen.
Victoria Erfesoglou makes her debut.
That's right.
In front of the camera.
It's fun to be on this side of the lens. Very excited.
Well, we're glad you can join us. Our other guest this evening, Javier Martinez. Javier. Welcome to the program for the first time.
First time here. I'm excited.
I know. It's going to be a good time. It's going to be a good show, ladies and gentlemen. We, like I said, we'll be with you for the next hour. We got some really good topics to discuss. You know, it's been a sad week here around Harris County with everything that went on and in the criminal justice system in general starting on Sunday night. We'll talk about all that. We'll also take your phone call starting at 830-713-807-1794 is the number. We have Twitter up. At HCCLA_TV. So please share your questions, your comments, anything you want to get in on this conversation. Feel free to join us right here on the air live. Like I said, guys, it's been kind of a downer of a week in the criminal courthouse. It started off Sunday. We learned of the passing of Judge Sandy Bilstein out in Fort Bend County.
Great judge.
Yeah.
Great human.
Yeah.
You have a story you can share?
Well, just briefly, I think that one of the only judges who supports the criminal defense lawyers who are trying to make it in this area and make some justice happen was Judge Bilstein. He was actually the first judge to appoint me my first misdemeanor case out in Fort Bend County. And it's one of the rare times I can honestly say that I've heard prosecutors and defense lawyers talk about him with high regard and just a very patient, objective, almost scientifically objective, fair kind of judge, and really embodied the concept of what you would want a judge to be. So it's a tragic loss, obviously, condolences to his family, but also wondering who's going to be able to fill those shoes. Just a wonderful human and a great judge out in Fort Bend County.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's one of those things, obviously, you know, and we, every time something like this happens, anytime there's a death in the legal community, it's interesting. We've had our fair share of them the last, year, for sure. It seems to come in waves, too. A lot of us, there's those of us who, in the community, were closer than others. I mean, there's a lot of people that you know from the courthouse and you see them and, you know, you interact with them maybe in court, but you don't get to know them outside of court or anything like that. But Judge Bilstein was one of those that I only appeared in front of him as a lawyer. I really didn't know him as a person. Unfortunately, I never got to know him really away from the bench so much. I had a couple interactions with him. But it was always just such a pleasure to be in his court. That's the biggest thing.
Yeah.
You always knew you were going to get an equal treatment, so to speak.
And going to what Victoria was saying, there's just been an outpouring of support for him from really young lawyers. You know, I've been practicing for about 3 years now, and every lawyer that I know that's similarly situated as I am would say, this guy gave me my first opportunity. Which says a lot about him. So definitely a big loss for the criminal defense community, and I'm sure for the DA's office down there in Fort Bend County as well.
When a judge no longer is able to serve, either through passage, through resignment, or through other, how are they? What happens to the bench?
Well, in this case, the county commissioners are going to, I would imagine, appoint someone to fill whatever is left of his term. And then, you know, it'll be that person will be able to run as an incumbent in the next election.
So, for example, with the 232nd and Luke Keel's court, or former Judge Luke Keel, or Judge Luke Keel, Justice Luke Keel, right?
Justice Luke Keel, that's right.
You know, they haven't, there's been kind of a rotating judge there. We've had a few individuals there for a long term. And there's all this undertone of appointment to that bench.
Mm-hmm.
Who, do you know anything about that process? How does that work? I really don't know. And I'm
well, because it's a district judge, district bench, the governor.
Oh.
County courts falls to the county commissioners.
Right.
District court goes to the governor. Governor would make the appointment.
You know, if...
It's all political.
Yeah, I was going to say.
So all those judges that lost a bench in this recent election, are, I assume, are gunning for that position.
But only one.
From what I've heard.
But only one's father is the most powerful one. I kid.
It's all politics. But the other really sad news from this week, of course, is the murder of Clint Greenwood. Precinct 3 deputy, who former prosecutor, was the former head of the Public Integrity Division under Pat Likas. He was a defense lawyer before that, and then went to the sheriff's office, Harris County Sheriff's Office, and just started at Precinct 3 this past January. Of course, it's been all over the news. He was murdered, cold blood, obviously a hit.
And they don't have anybody apprehended yet,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Which is phenomenal to me. Was this some sort of, is it just that easy to get away with murder? Or at least at this phase, right? Or is this guy, this happened, like some, Clint Eastwood movie?
I mean, look, this touches on a much broader topic that I kind of want to get into about this. There is no doubt in my mind, although it hasn't been explicitly said, there's been rumblings of it. There's no doubt that this was somebody he prosecuted.
Sure.
He prosecuted police officers.
Right.
The manner in which this was done. Now, there was some erroneous reporting in the news, go figure, at the start about whether it was a sniper rifle and something, somebody shot at a long distance. Immediately, first thing that got into my mind was, it's a hit, and it's a former police officer. Or somebody that a former police officer hired to do the job. But then the reports became a little more clear that it was somebody who walked right up to him and shot him right in the face.
Wow.
Yeah.
Especially this email that, they said that he sent over to the county attorney's mm-hmm. office saying that, I think this person is a threat to me and my family.
Right.
And who else would it be but somebody that he prosecuted? Something about corruption or something
yep.
like that, which it's kind of scary because sort of calculated, maybe somebody that covered their tracks, knew the system, knew what the police would be looking for. So, we'll see what happens with that.
It makes sense. I mean, we know corruption exists, and this is a man who headed internal affairs investigations mm-hmm. and investigated police misconduct. And I think one of the articles said that when help arrived, he was actually still standing by his car.
Yes.
With a wound to his neck.
So alive?
That's what it sounded like, that they actually life-flighted him to the hospital. So I don't know. Maybe I'd like to think they have some information that they have not released. Maybe he was able to say, but maybe not.
Yeah,
I don't know.
I don't know. What I do know is that Devin Anderson, our former DA, was put under protection. So that clearly leads me to believe that they have a pretty good idea, at least of a short list of suspects.
Mm-hmm.
Again, it really talks about what we do. Prosecutors, police officers, defense lawyers. We talked a lot about on this show over the last year about all the police shootings that happened. But really, it's everybody in this system that can be at risk. Whether you are a lawyer, whether you're a judge, whether you are a court staff, we've seen situations where people get out of control in courtrooms, and stuff happens. And this is just one more reminder. I don't believe that he was shot because he was a police officer. That's not what I believe.
Then he got shot because of what he knew?
Yes.
I believe he was killed because either he prosecuted somebody and this was a vengeance, or because he was investigating somebody. I mean, there is nothing that cops hate more than the cops that investigate them.
Thank God for those cops.
Right.
Absolutely. Yeah.
It's true. Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, that's the only thing I can really think. I mean, it's just it's. I don't know. It's scary when stuff like that happens because, you know, it could be any of us.
And it's scary to think how that will deter further investigations into law enforcement misconduct. And, you know, you think about all of the deaths that happened at Harris County Jail. I know we've talked about that on another show. And some of the investigations that are involved in those deaths that happened at the jail and by other officers using force. And it's a tragedy that this man, this lawyer, was killed. And it's also tragic to think how other investigations could be deterred, because people are afraid. They're afraid to talk about corruption, police misconduct, or to come forward with information potentially. So it's a big, big topic.
And just, you know, going back to what Jimmy was saying about somebody that he knew and somebody that he was investigating, just the way that it was done. I mean, he shows up at 7 a.m. and it appears like somebody was waiting for him, somebody that knew his routine, knew what time he was going to get there, and, you know, just executed him, basically.
What's this video of this? They said it was a suspect, but in the video, it doesn't really show any suspicious. Is it just he was at the place at the time?
Yeah, I think it was a person in a vehicle around that area at the time. But, you know, a couple years ago, there was a lawyer who was killed up in Dallas. Who was representing a cartel, member, and there have been several instances like that. I don't think people realize the number of times in criminal and family law where the lawyers are actually threatened. Whether you're a prosecutor, whether you're a defense lawyer, whether you're representing the husband, whether you're representing the wife. I mean, I've honestly had people. You know, who have come to my office, who and not even on a criminal case, just a regular civil case, a personal injury case that I didn't want to take, and the people have come back to my office, and we had to have them physically escorted out of the building because they were upset that somebody wouldn't take their case. There was a case years ago in Beaumont where a similar thing, a personal injury client was very upset with the firm for not taking his case. And he came back, was very agitated. One of the partners took him back into the office, and that man was wielding a shotgun underneath a long coat and shot down that partner dead in his office. Stuff like this happens. And I don't think, you know, to some degree, we all go about our business at the courthouse every day, unsuspecting of what could be going on behind the scenes.
I was walking out of the courthouse this morning, and I thought to myself, man, that captain was just going to work that day and was killed.
Yeah.
And, you know, I thought to me, you realize how precious life is, what are the real important things in life, and it really makes you think. Do you all, question, are you all surprised or not surprised that the person who this captain felt threatened by isn't in custody yet? Should he be? Are you surprised that we don't know who this guy is yet?
Well, and the look, we had, and it kind of, you know, one of the other topics I wanted to discuss was Michael Kubosch, and
sure,
how he felt threatened. We'll get to that in a moment because it kind of ties into this. But, you know, that was a murder for hire case. What's to say this wasn't?
Could be.
What's to say there is not a police officer who is currently sitting in custody somewhere who didn't arrange this?
Mm-hmm. It was certainly premeditated.
Absolutely. You know, so I mean, I think there's still a lot of things that need to be worked out, and a full investigation needs to be done. But I mean, that's the thing. Why is there nobody in custody? Because maybe that person is long gone.
Yeah, that's the first thing that came to mind when I read that they've established a special task force to investigate and still don't have anybody. I mean, it seems like that kind of arranged killing would have thought about the consequences and fleeing afterwards.
It would have had an escape plan.
That's what I'm saying. Is it some Clint Eastwood, Harrison movie, you know, The Fugitive, like, or, I mean, because we hear about, you know, if you, and I do think, and I have faith in our prosecutors and our, and the government, whoever committed this horrible crime is going to be brought to justice in due time. They will find you and they will get you. However, seriously, it's been a couple days. This guy came up and shot somebody in the face and killed him, killed a man. And there's 60,000 out for him. I mean, they find, we get clients in court every day who get arrested and who are the subjects of, you know, this guy wasn't just this lucky to get away and to not be arrested by now.
And let's think about where we live. We live in Harris County, you know, one of the biggest police forces in the United States. And looking back to recent history with the Shannon Miles case, I mean, they had a suspect in custody, what, within 24 hours or so?
They even arrested the wrong dude for that killing, the assault on that little boy that was walking from school. They arrested the wrong guy and then had to apologize. Here we have a guy, I mean, I won't say it, but I mean, there's...
It seems like they might, especially since they're putting people like Devin Anderson under protection. I think they have more information than we know, possibly.
Why Devin? Why is Devin being... But why?
It raises some eyebrows.
Do you think it's because he was under Devin's... Was he under the Devin regime?
He left in 2013.
So then at some point he had to have been. He was.
Yeah, I mean, possibly. You don't know how far the investigation could have extended to multiple people under... I don't know the details of what, you know, the corruption investigation that he was referring to when he made the report to the county attorney's office. But, you know, it's tough because, you know, you think about stuff. I mean, I used to see Clint all the time around the courthouse. I mean, he was there every day, you know. And before he went to the sheriff's office, obviously, I mean, both as a defense lawyer and a prosecutor. And that's the thing. Again, he's not one of those people I had a close personal relationship with. But, I mean, you knew him. I mean, you'd talk to him. But, I mean, I've heard stories from a lot of people. I officed with him, and he was just so generous to a young lawyer, willing to help him out. I mean, that's the type of person everybody has their own memories of the people within the courthouse, and some are closer than others. And it's when stuff like this happens, you know, when somebody passes away and you hear stories like this and you hear the good things that people say about them, and obviously there'll be some bad stuff. I mean, there are going to be a lot of people who have a lot of bad things to say about them too, I'm sure. But when you hear stuff like that, it, you know, and you hear the outpouring like on Judge Bielstein about giving young lawyers chances, I don't know, for me, it makes me regret not being able to get to know these people better.
We've had a lot of hits to the soldiers of justice recently.
Yeah. But, you know, it's hard. It's hard to balance all this out. And you just realize, like, man, if this guy had chosen to do this at the courthouse and spray a bunch of gunfire, it could have taken out anybody.
And some of us are solo practitioners. You know, we go to crime scenes. We go out to interview witnesses. You know, I mean, I have colleagues who do that sort of thing on a regular basis. And I do it on a regular basis. If I can't get an investigator or other lawyer to go with me, you know, I try to take precautions. But we put ourselves in those risks with this job all the time.
I remember, and my wife's gonna kill me when she hears me saying this on air if she's watching. I remember when I was earning my stripes, Anthony also, he tries a lot of capital murders. And when we still do this, I mean, we still are there with him, but when he was first kind of trying Daniel and I out as helping out in his cases, he'd say, "Why don't you go to this address and go knock on some doors and try to, you know, see what you can find." "Yes, yeah, no problem, Anthony. We'll get out there, no problem." And so we get there, and he gives us, you know, things to know about the case, and we're driving there, and you look, and it's like, we're going where? And we're going to ask about what? And we're going to, seriously? And so we'd go to these places, knock on doors.
Like, I'm not trained for this.
Fully suited down. Yeah. And like, so a couple days ago, someone was killed over here next door. You know anybody or who might have been involved in this, or you know anything. Man, it was the scariest stuff. But then you're there, and to be a good defense lawyer, you get and learn things when you go to the scene, to the crime scene. You go and you see, oh wait, that chair was actually over here. What about old Crazy Joe down the street that we, you know? And you don't get those without at least knowing those parts. Now, granted, you generally want to send an investigator out there, yeah, but sure, sometimes you just can't.
You know, and I have to say, I've never been scared of my clients. I always feel like I get along, you know, pretty well with my clients. And I have a friend who's a school teacher, and I remember when the last school shooting was happening, commenting to her that I actually feel safer walking into a jail to interview my client than you must feel going to school to do your job and teach children. So, you know, I guess it's kind of relative dealing with the dangers and gun violence in America, but I think we do have risks associated with some of the people we...
Well, look at Michael Kubosh. I mean, he the source of how the murder for hire case in the veterinarian got uncovered, and he came out and answered a bunch of questions. Now, I mean, I don't know that I fully understand how his statement was caused to go out and set up the fake, based on what he told the Chronicle anyway.
He set the deal up.
Yeah.
Like,
but now he feels like he feels threatened. He's in fear of his safety for the defendant that's left.
He calls the D and's like, yeah. Imagine that conversation. I know so and so. You should meet him over here at such and such time and date. That must have been the most scariest time, one of the, if not the scariest time of not only Councilman Kubosh's life, but I'd imagine anyone's life. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I mean, yeah.
No.
So the client, so the defendant interacts with Kubosh, Councilman Kubosh, says, hey, you know this guy, he's gonna take care of it. Kubosh calls the chief of police, Acevedo, who I saw in the elevator yesterday, said what's up to him, told him he's doing a good job, keep the good work.
Hook him horns.
Hook him horns, yeah.
Close personal friend.
Yeah, you know, calls him personally. Then Kubosh becomes this guy, essential piece to the entire puzzle of bringing this down, who very well saved a life, saved two lives.
Well, here's one thing to consider. At what point do the prosecutors tell Mr. Kubosh, hey, you might want to keep a lid on these things? Because he's a state witness.
Exactly.
What I was kind of baffled about is sort of, here is Councilman Kubosh, and he sets up this press conference in front of his bail bonds office, and just talking about the facts of the case. I mean, at what point does the DA's office, Major Offenders Division, is like, hey, you might want to tone this down a little bit. Of course, politics. I'm sure that Mr. Kubosh wants to save face in one way or another, probably his business. But I'm wondering at what time the DA's office, you know, stops and say, hey, there's a presumption of innocence here. Yeah. You might want to tone it down.
You know, and frankly, if I'm the defense lawyer in that case, I make hay of what are your motivations? What really were you trying to set up here kind of thing? But,
Which is another drama because Parnum was in it, then somebody else came on, and then Parnum withdrew, and then Parnum came back.
Parnum's back?
Oh, Parnum's back now?
Yeah,
I didn't hear
from
that.
Last time.
He's breaking.
Wow. No.
All drama.
That's awesome.
Well, I guess we'll find out about that. I'm going to throw you all for a little curve here because there was a topic I forgot to add in. But you reminded me of it, actually, and that I wanted to throw in. And that was you talked about Shannon Miles earlier. Nope. And I want to talk about the recusal this week because Kim Ogg announced she was recusing herself from Shannon Miles, her office, from Shannon Miles' prosecution, and that was, of course, in the murder of Deputy Goforth, Darren Goforth. So she recuses the whole office because her now chief of staff, Vivian King, represented two of Miles' family members in the investigation. Now, I think it's the proper thing to do.
Yes. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yes.
I mean, you know, your office, somebody in your office who's now higher up in your office has interviewed represented family members of the defendant in this case, I think it's a proper move. However, you've now opened yourself up to a ton of criticism for picking and choosing this case to recuse on, but not recusing yourself on the David Temple case. So how does she draw the distinction, guys, between being able to say, I'm going to recuse my office here because of the relationship between lawyers in my office and witnesses, but I'm not going to recuse myself on a case with lawyers in my office and the defendant? How does she justify that, guys?
Okay, devil's advocate, could it be because of the new office policies and administration that she's implemented? I mean, in your mind, what would be the reason for her to recuse her office from the Temple case?
She has lawyers and now chief of the intake division, who I know, but who worked on the case?
Temple case.
Who represented Temple, who worked for Temple. And, you know, I'm just throwing it out there. I'm not trying to advocate one way or another. I'm
right.
just saying that this really puts her in a tough spot, potentially with people, because there are tons of calls for her to step aside on the Temple case and ask for a special prosecutor.
Well, politically, is one better to step away from than the other? If I was her, I'd want to go after the accused cop killer if I was that angle.
Not if you are an anti-death penalty prosecutor who's taking money from anti-death penalty groups.
True. So let's ask this. Does her opening up the availability of a special prosecutor, what if you get a pro-death penalty special prosecutor? And and that might backfire on you. You see what I'm saying? Like, if she's supposed to be a champion of,
These are the arguments that are out there, guys.
Well,
maybe
there should be a difference when prosecutorial misconduct is involved.
Ooh.
Because that's, I think, one of the biggest differences in my mind with Temple versus, another crime that may have a conflict because someone at the DA's office now used to be a defense attorney. So It would seem to me that if you're going to need a special prosecutor to investigate all instances of prosecutorial misconduct, that could get out of control if you want to actually target prosecutorial misconduct.
Well,
I don't have the statistics.
I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that the criticism that's being levied against her right now is that if she's taking the position that she cannot prosecute Shannon Miles because now one of her senior level lawyers represented witnesses. Yeah. How does she justify, what's her argument for being able to keep the Temple case?
Well, let me throw a theory out there, and let me give Kim Ogg the benefit of the doubt.
Sure.
Shannon Miles is in the 185th District Court. That's Judge Susan Brown.
Yep.
She's a very fast moving docket. What if she is tackling one thing at a time and Shannon Miles is the most pressing thing because it's been pending for a long time. She wants to, and she's evaluated everything. So she said, okay, there's conflict here. I'm gonna appoint someone or I'm gonna recuse myself. Maybe Temple is the next thing on her plate.
Maybe.
And she's reviewing the case because that's what she says she's doing, at least her office says. And I hope she does the right thing because from everything that we're reading, there seems to be some conflict there.
Well, District Attorney Kim Ogg can come and explain her position on the show. We'd love to have her back, I think.
A thousand invites. We're going to Facebook that. We're going to cut that and put it up. But, okay, so that's tough. That is super. And so Miles has been found competent.
And if you want to weigh in, by the way, we will open up the phone lines now to jump in. 713-807-1794 is the number. And also, we got Twitter up at HCCLA_TV. But continue your thought, Julio.
So he's been found competent. And so he's going to go to trial. I do not know, and if y'all know, if they're going to be seeking death or just life.
I don't know that.
I don't think they've made that decision yet.
Interesting. There's so much stuff to know. That way the case can move
forward. I guess we'll find out when the special prosecutor is assigned.
Yeah.
Maybe Montgomery County, maybe the AG's office, maybe some defense lawyer. I mean, who knows?
Who has a say in that? And so it goes back to, what if they want to seek death on him? Or what if some of the things that they're going to pursue is in some... I mean, well, who picks the special prosecutor?
That's not all the special... Well,
I think the judge appoints it, doesn't
he? The judge, yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay, fair. I think that's fair.
Yeah, I still... You guys haven't answered the question.
Non-responsive.
How does she justify it?
It's got to be political.
Let's jump in on the phone. We got a phone call coming in, so maybe this person will answer my question. Hello, thank you for calling Reasonable Doubt.
Well, I've got a question of my own, and what I'd like to know is, with the recent activity in the Texas legislature, regarding the bail bondsman, and Kubosh is within that set. What's going to happen to these people that are going to be looking for work, and how long is it going to take? Do you think this change in the law, which I think is coming to take effect? That's the first part of the question, and the second part would be: do you see defense attorneys as getting a better chance to achieve justice for their clientele if they don't have to plead? As they had before, in order to get out of jail.
Certainly, and just for clarification, on the first part of your question, what people are you referring to looking for jobs?
A bail bondsman.
You're talking about the comment this week about how they would be put out of business.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. But good, great questions. There was a comment this week, I guess, that they at the legislature this whole thing, what the county's trying to do in terms of passing bail bond reform is going to put bail bondsmen out of business. Okay.
How?
I don't think so.
Yeah.
I would
still
going to
be bonds
how.
To be posted.
Yeah.
Maybe not the volume, but there's still be bonds.
Do they even make money off misdemeanor bonds? I mean,
well, that's what I'm saying. We don't even see that. I don't remember the last time I've seen a lot of marijuana cases coming through the courthouse, like small, like.
But here's the question. I mean, okay, the bondsman can say we're going to lose money, but they're not getting those people anyway, because guess what? They're in custody, so they're not making a bond. That's
right.
That's the
no,
whole
we're
point.
We're talking about
you can't make money
or,
if people don't post the bond.
Right.
Yeah, that's
you know.
Right.
And so, I think that probably the people that are making the bonds, yes, they'll lose that business, but I think the problem here is that there are far more people who are staying in custody than need be, and
it's like you said, Jimmy. I mean, there are people who have no means of making a bond. Period. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter if it's $50,000 or $5,000, and are entitled to a PR bond. Probably should have had one a long time ago, and are still sitting in jail. And I just don't see how that's going to put bondsmen out of business.
Well, and the criminal justice system should not be. The interest of the criminal justice system should not be to make private businesses money. It shouldn't
Absolutely.
Be to make private prisons money. It shouldn't be the priority of the criminal justice system should not be to the profits of private industry. Okay? Unfortunately, it's kind of become that way between private prisons and everything else. That's unfortunately, criminal justice has become a big business. Yeah. It shouldn't be though. It shouldn't be.
Yeah, and I think this reform is hopefully one way to combat that, at least in our county. Everybody should rally behind it, I think, if it's going to make that change.
I can't wait to see the galleries and the hallways just filled with people that were initially in custody, that would have been in custody, and they're just everywhere. And the district attorney's office is going to have to make some changes.
Well, that goes to the caller's second part of his question. I mean, do you guys legitimately see a difference in the way, or feel that there will be a difference in the way prosecutors will handle cases if we've got more people who are out on bond?
They're going to have to.
I hope so, but I've in my experience, I think it varies from courtroom to courtroom, and I wish that it didn't, but it does. And in some courtrooms, I've noticed judges being more amenable to giving PR bonds. And, you know, we've talked about this, or y'all have talked about this on the show before. You just fight the case differently if you're not in custody. You can do more things to investigate and try to seek justice. And I've seen prosecutors that don't care. They don't care about... I've had prosecutors this past week fight me on asking for a bond reduction or PR bond. So I don't know. I hope that it will change, but I think that it's just whatever they can get away with.
Maybe I'm just like hoping.
Well, no,
maybe,
look, you know. I mean, here's what I see. I don't see that it will change necessarily. Because, look, if you ain't got the facts, you ain't got the facts.
True.
All right? Your client either has to do a deal or they have the ability to take it to trial, right? So maybe you'll see a few more cases where people get pushed to trial where they wouldn't otherwise because they're like, I'm not sitting in jail. What's the risk, you know? But I don't think there's going to be a difference because the only difference is this. It will actually give people time to think about the consequences of the plea. Because, you know, sometimes you might get two or three different options, right? They might say,
right.
Well, you can have, let's just take a felony, okay? They might give you options. They may say, all right, you can do deferred on a felony with these conditions. Or we'll reduce it to a misdemeanor, but it has to be a misdemeanor conviction with X time in the county jail. Or if you want a misdemeanor deferred, there's all these conditions, which, like, for instance, in a family violence case, they may insist on the affirmative finding of family violence if it's reduced to a misdemeanor, whereas if you went on felony, they might not. So I'm just throwing an example out there. So you got three different options, right? Well, now your client's not forced to make the decision in a holdover cell that day. You can reset the case, give them 30 days, and then you can contemplate which of those options is best for the long term of their future.
Let me ask your opinion on something. What do you think, let's say we have a hypothetical defendant, client, who's got a criminal history, a long one, but all for nonviolent offenses.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe you can explain to the viewers how that might fit in with a determination on what their bond should be and whether they should have a PR bond. But do you think that that affects or should have any weight in deciding whether they are dangerous to the community?
For a bond?
For bond purposes.
I mean, criminal history goes into determining whether or not, you know, someone's a danger to the community.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so,
I mean, absolutely. If you've got, and there's a difference. I mean, look, if somebody's been, got, let's say, five burglary of a motor vehicles or burglary of a habitation, that's a lot different from five weed charges,
right.
Possession charges.
That was going to be my
okay?
next. What
so
if they're drug offenses?
So, yeah. So, I mean, they can be, but... We got another call coming in. Let's jump over to the phone lines. Hello, thanks for calling Reasonable Doubt.
To put another layer over the first two questions I asked.
Sure.
Do the judges have the kind of budget that it would require to increase the caseload for people that require representation? Do they have that kind of budget? Because I see two or three times the amount of folks that are appointed, attorneys that are appointed to represent these people that are that come into the system and need representation from the defense attorneys. Do judges have that kind of budget?
I will say, if I can respond, now starting I think Monday, this past Monday. We have more attorneys in the courtroom that the judge has, or the more money to spend, or the county has been allocated more money to have more lawyers in the courtroom. So I think we're seeing that now as part of the county's effort to change some bail reform, or to initiate bail reform. However, I don't think they have enough money. I don't think they have, okay, but we don't have enough money for investigators, and we don't have enough, I mean, granted, it's a misdemeanor court, but they still need investigation, and they still need experts.
But whether they're in or out of custody, they still gonna have to have an appointed lawyer.
Right.
Right. So I'm not sure how that would require more money. What is this influx of lawyers?
I mean, I guess if you think about that, maybe they're going to have more settings if they're out on bond. It's an increase in the money that's being spent, because I don't know how it works, but I believe that you get paid on the for the settings, right?
Felonies, you get paid by setting. You get paid day and then setting. On misdemeanors, you get paid daily. You do get paid setting if you're not in a term, but the misdemeanor, you make your money on the day, attorney of the day, setting.
But this also makes increasing the size and scope of the public defender's office, I think, now a more valid argument, because that money is not in the judicial budget, but rather in the county budget and would come from county commissioners.
But if I may inject,
sure.
The people are, you know, the defendants are not going to plea nearly as much if an appropriately long look has been given at whether or not they can afford a PR, or they qualify for a PR bond.
They shouldn't be pleading.
I disagree with you there. I disagree with you to this extent. Mm-hmm. If a person. Look, it goes back to, if you don't have the facts on your side and you can't win the case, any lawyer, any good lawyer is going to advise their client, look, you are going to possibly face a substantially different punishment if you go to trial and lose versus taking this deal. And so, I mean, the reality is 90% of the practice of criminal law is mitigation, okay? And so... You know, if you can't find that search issue, or you can't find some little technicality to get the case kicked, 9 times out of 10 the facts are just not on your side.
Sure.
And so you can either pull the bluff, you can play the role of Kenny Rogers and the gambler, and see what happens, and whether or not, you know, a complaining witness shows up, and sometimes that's the best route to take. But sometimes, more often than not, the best route is to have your attorney negotiate with the prosecutor and say, look, you got risk here, we got risk here, let's figure out a place to meet in the middle. And that's how the majority of these cases are resolved. And so I don't think you're going to see this just huge uptick in trials.
No, and we have a national epidemic. Then when I said they shouldn't be pleading, is they shouldn't be pleading just because they don't want to sit in jail. I mean,
correct.
Obviously that's the reality that a lot of people are in. They're in jail, they want to get out, they'll take a deal for anything.
Yeah.
You know, that's where they shouldn't be pleading. But
I also think that they are pleading to deals. Say what you will about the people, and there's a huge problem with people pleading to drug cases where they didn't have drugs, but let's take those anomalies out of the system. The real problem I see is that people perhaps are pleading to misdemeanor convictions when they could, if they had some more time and be able to examine the case, yet they still may enter a plea, but they might be able to get a deferred adjudication.
Or something.
Right.
Or something that doesn't stay on their record.
Information, right. you said, mitigation.
Right. Right. Yeah. Whereas it's an easy fix for a prosecutor to say, hey, I'll give him time served. Well, bam, that's a conviction.
Yeah.
He's less likely to offer the guy sitting in the audience a time served.
Right.
Right. And you are setting this up for life, because a lot of even misdemeanor convictions have long-lasting consequences.
Correct.
Especially for young people who maybe don't even know what they want to do with their life, go to school, get a career by some licensing board that's not going to give them a license now because they have this misdemeanor conviction, just because you wanted to get them off the docket quickly. I mean, it's tragic if you think about it.
Assault family members, we talked about affirmative findings earlier. Those things are bad.
I mean, hell,
things are horrible.
It's a lot easier to have the time to even try to get a pretrial diversion if your client is out.
Exactly.
Getting a pretrial diversion while your client is in custody?
Impossible.
Impossible. I mean, right. No.
And for the people that don't know, pretrial diversion program is a Harris County program that can help, if you complete it successfully, help keep your record clean.
And going
so
back
it's
to
really
it,
valuable.
Going back to what Jimmy was saying, you know, getting deferred adjudication instead of pleading guilty, time served, or something. As defense lawyers, we know that the closer the case goes to trial, a lot of times on trial day, you'll get the best deal. Mm-hmm. And sometimes people don't want to wait that long. I mean, sometimes you walk into the holdover and the person says, I just want to get out of here. And you still don't have all the evidence that you need to defend this person. So I agree with you when you say that if you prolong the process, it could save this person's, you know, life, his future career aspirations. And, you know, that's a big part of the reform.
Yeah, I mean, time is on the side of the defense in criminal cases.
Right.
For the most part.
Yeah.
There are very few criminal cases where you want it resolved quickly. I mean, it's the truth.
That's right.
The only time I want a case resolved quickly is when I open the file and I see there was a knife, broken bones, and a bunch of drugs involved, and nobody's caught on to it yet.
Yeah,
we'll take time served. Yeah, we'll go sure. 30 days.
Nobody's caught on to the fact that, this could be a felony, actually.
Yes, no.
And it's only charged as a misdemeanor. Yeah, we'll go ahead and do that.
Forfeit the weapon? What? Huh? Sure.
We got another call coming in. Let's jump over to the phone lines and take our next call. Hello. Thanks for calling Reasonable Doubt.
Thank you guys for taking my question.
Absolutely.
It's a little bit off from tonight, but last week you guys were talking about the grand jury, I guess, if you were going to be indicted. Now they're trying to bring up, I guess they'll let you know in advance. And y'all kind of didn't get into it, but, I kind of have a thing. My son got indicted by a grand jury. We had no, we didn't know anything about it. And then, you have bail money you have to put up to get you out of jail. And it's here in Midland County. And luckily we had a lawyer there that you guys deal with, Mark Bennett, come down and do our case for us a couple of weeks ago. And we were found not guilty, but
congratulations.
You know, we still brought up. Thank you so much.
Wow,
he's really a great lawyer, I'm sure.
Oh yeah.
You guys have Twitter account with him. He was on his Twitter account a couple of weeks ago talking about the Midland County
railing on the Midland County DA. Yeah.
Yeah.
Was this the case?
Yeah.
That's awesome. That's awesome.
And that cost us. We were probably into that about $110,000.
Now we know how much Mark.
Yeah.
Makes.
Now we got. Now.
Head this off.
Yeah. So what? Your question,
how
sir?
How do y'all feel about that? I think they should let you know if you're going to be brought up on a grand jury, because in the grand jury indictment, when it's nothing to what the case was about, because the prosecutor can go in there and kind of put what she wants there and feed it to the grand jury. And of course, if anybody hears what the charge was, and I'll just tell you what it was: online solicitation of a minor, which was she was found not guilty of. But if you bring that up to the grand jury and you kind of put it the way you want to put it, they're gonna indict you on that, of course, and then you're thousands and thousands of dollars into this.
Yeah.
I just want to see what you guys thought about that.
Absolutely, appreciate the call.
Thank you.
Of course, that was a statute that Mark Bennett overturned. If we're talking about the same online solicitation of a minor statute, but sometimes you can do a grand jury packet as a defense lawyer, but it's kind of a rare occurrence because you have to catch the case early enough. You have to talk to the prosecutor and make sure that they, will hold off going to the grand jury so that you can prepare a packet. And it's a really great opportunity as a defense lawyer because you can put so much in there that obviously the prosecutor is not going to know or bring up. So that's a quick way to maybe deal with the case and get it no-billed if you have the chance.
This is a great kind of segue into the homeowner who, in Montgomery County, was arrested for felony charges.
Yep.
And so I'll let an update get into what happened. However, on the caller's point, while we're talking about grand juries, he went in front of a judge, a probable cause judge, and the probable cause judge said, "This I find no probable cause." And so when that happens, the district attorney still has the ability and power to take that case to a grand jury to get indicted. And I wonder if the Montgomery County DA will do that. I don't know. What's the story? Yeah, I mean,
in this case, there was a homeowner who he found some guys basically assaulting his wife, and so he chased them down and fired shots out in the neighborhood, and so the police, this guy's basically protecting his wife, and he ends up getting arrested, for, you know, firing shots indiscriminately out in the neighborhood, these guys.
Montgomery County DA goes and indicts it. Javier, are you taking this case to trial?
Yeah, because there's a video that, you know, shows that he was acting, you know, in defense of his wife. And I think the interesting part about that case is the investigator started questioning the accused, and because he had a Tango Blast
right.
Tattoo, you know, that's probably why they arrested him.
They thought he was in a gang.
They thought it was gang related, and you know, because of a.
And I guess if you are a gang member or gang related, you don't have the right to defend yourself. Or
right.
He wouldn't be the first person indicted on murder for. Well, nobody. He didn't. It sounds like he didn't catch anybody or shoot anybody. But you know, I was on a murder case, one of the first trial ever sat on, and we were acquitted. With self-defense and defense of others. He was defending his wife, but that case was pending for 3 years. He was indicted.
Was this the shot into the Suburban or?
It was at an apartment complex, and the man who was killed was known to be in a gang, but our client wasn't, and they were not offering anything good. It was a 40-year offer, and he was acquitted. We were in trial for like a week.
But so, here's the issue, though. I mean, you talk about the DA's office up in Montgomery County being able to go in and get this case reindicted. The grand jury is likely never to learn that a judge found no probable cause unless the defense lawyer is able to put together a packet
right.
and say, hey, guess what, guys? A judge already looked at this, and they said there was no probable cause. But if I'm the prosecutor, I'm not going to let you present that packet because I know that's what you're going to do.
Wow. Well, if you're seeking justice, you should.
But if you're trying to keep your job, you
well,
let's, let's think about where our venue is too.
That's my County. Point. That's why I say if I'm a prosecutor there, I probably ain't letting you do a grand jury packet.
I've done a couple in Montgomery County, but
I mean, I guess it just depends on who the prosecutor is and whether or not they really, really want this case.
Do not include a picture of your client with a Tango Blast tattoo on his neck.
Yeah. Maybe you can get a picture with him and a cuddly bunny for Easter with his kids.
You do your grand jury packets, Hop?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we use them on sometimes pre-investigation, you know, when the police comes knocking on our client's door and, you know, they're thinking about filing charges, and sometimes we stop them from filing the actual charges at the DA's office, but if they file the charges, we put together a grand jury packet presentation. And the Harris County DA's office is, I think, really good about letting you present grand jury presentations. I don't think it's that way in smaller counties. I think this gentleman was in Midland County. We did a grand jury presentation in Midland County once. But I think it's less common in sort of smaller counties, but it's pretty common in Harris County. And I've never had a problem with a prosecutor telling me in Harris County, no, you can't present this.
And always get it in writing. Follow up with an email. I think that helps. Thanks for letting me do a grand jury packet. I'll do it next week or whatever the case may be. But I've always been able to do one when a prosecutor told me they would wait. So I haven't run into a prosecutor lying about that.
Yeah, I mean, it's a hard decision whether or not to do that grand jury packet. And to the caller's point, I mean, being able the grand jury reform and whether or not you should do it. I mean, look, you know, what if being able to make that really didn't change the outcome at the grand jury level, but all it did was tip the prosecutor off as to what your defenses were.
That's
right. It's a delicate balance as a lawyer.
And so that's the rub is that. Yeah. You know, yeah, you may have the ability to head this thing off, but for instance, look, in Montgomery County, that is probably a place that it might be, given the demographics up there, it might be very difficult to, even with a packet, convince the grand jury to no-bill this case. It just might be.
Sure.
I'm not saying that, but you don't get to go in there and really, it's one thing to be able to emotionally argue and show the video and everything about the assault. But if you're just writing out a packet and it's on a cold paper and you're just handing it to them, I think there's something as there was a movie that Bill Murray made called Lost in Translation.
Yeah, I saw that.
And I think that there's probably some something that's lost in the translation there.
Right, because, you know, the grand jury is hearing cases all day.
Mm-hmm.
All day. So then you put this patent, you know, five-page letter with exhibits, and now you have a 15 to 20-page packet. And you, I mean, I wonder, is like, did they read this thing, or are they reading all of this? So that's a good point.
I think that the length of it is definitely one of, there was a CLE recently, and a grand juror actually came and made some comments. It was an HCCLA CLE, and that's one of the things he mentioned is, you know, brevity is important, and but they look at them, they do look at them, and he was saying that, you know, pictures can be important. Whatever portrait that you want to paint of your client that the prosecutor isn't going to do, and it's a case-by-case basis, I think,
whether you do one. I think the most effective grand jury packets that I've found are the ones where you have actual facts that are 180 degrees opposite of what the offense report says.
That can't be changed once the prosecutor is made aware of them.
Correct.
Right.
I mean, those are the most effective grand jury packets because the only thing the prosecutor's walking in there is the cop's offense report. And if you've got something that just is, you know, the silver bullet that knocks it out, those are the ones that I find are the most effective because it's something that the prosecutor wouldn't even be able to overcome at trial.
I like doing polygraph examinations on sexual assault of a child, indecency with a child. You put that polygraph in front of a grand jury, and a lot of times they'll go for that.
The polygraph is very, very powerful, I think, in front of a grand jury, because that's something that a normal jury doesn't get.
Right.
Right.
And so,
if your client can afford one, it could be a really good, good way to go.
I had this one where, in my grand jury packet, I included the district attorney and I's emails, where the district attorney said something to the effect of, "Yeah, I really don't believe her either, but we're gonna just go ahead and proceed." Yeah, I put that in my packet. Yeah, I put that in my, and they presented it, and my guy got no build.
Victoria, we're running out of time, and I know you want to talk about this.
How much time do we have left?
It's like a minute. No, here's the plan. Here's
DNA.
The plan.
Okay, so
we're
go.
Here's the plan. I think you and Betsy come on the show.
Okay.
And we can have like a power team DNA
because sure.
I think it's fabulous.
Sure, I'll be happy to ask her. I'm hoping that she'll be available. I think she would be.
I think she's watching, actually.
Okay, well, Betsy, please come on with me and talk about the DNA mixture review project.
We were going to get a little update from you tonight, but we've rambled on about too much other stuff. I mean...
But it was good. It flew by.
I agree.
It flew by.
How about, I think we're going to be off. Hey, everybody, I think we're here next week.
We're here next week, and then we're off... The next 2 weeks?
Next two, and then we're back on, and then banquet.
And for we have the HCCLA banquet coming up May 11th. So if you have not bought your tickets, if you are a criminal defense lawyer, paralegal, anybody, or you're just generally overall interested in hanging out with a bunch of criminal defense lawyers on May 11th.
We're fun.
Come on out. Get your tickets on hccla.org. You can get them right there. And join us May 11th at the Zaza Hotel. What's the time, guys? 7 p.m.? Probably drinks
usually.
At 6?
Yeah.
I think it's 6 p.m. to 3 a.m.
Yeah, I said we're fun. You should come. Yeah.
That's the way to plug it.
Yeah.
Like, I'll buy you a drink.
3 a.m.
Buy you a drink.
Julio will buy you more than one drink.
I'll buy you two drinks. I'll buy you two drinks.
Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, like I said, we'll be back next week with another great cast of characters here to keep you entertained. For Javier Martinez, Victoria Erfesoglou, and my co-host Julio Vela, I'm Jimmy Ardwan. Good night, ladies and gentlemen.